Okay, let's call the meeting to order. Jen, can we do roll call? Mr. Bullock?
I'm here.
Ms. Owens? Yes. Ms. Weber? Mr. Smith?
Here.
Mr. Moldaver?
Here.
And Ms. Lomas?
Here.
Thank you. Great. Did everybody get a chance to look at the minutes from March 18th? Wonderful. Do we have a motion?
Move to accept as submitted.
Second.
Okay, any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. I abstain. I was not here.
You missed an exciting meeting.
I know. I'm sorry. Any agenda adjustments?
No.
Okay, any public comment?
Madam Chair, besides a really terrific audience today, we've got two great students from Santa Barbara City College from Adam Green's class in environmental science. So I was wondering if they would each come up and introduce themselves and talk a little bit about their class or their career if they want to.
I think that's an excellent idea.
Yeah. And that way it'll be proof positive to your professor that you are actually here. Yeah, come on up.
So we both go to Santa Barbara City College. We're in the environmental studies class. I'm a business major right now, and we're just here to check it out and see what's going on in the community. So we're excited.
Wonderful.
Yeah.
I'm Marquise, and I came here to participate to see what our community is doing to and like how we're taking action in the creek, like what's going on, what's polluting our creek. So it'd be interesting to see what's going on around there. And yeah, just this, for, yeah. Thank you.
Yeah, if you want to stick around after and talk to any of us about it, please do.
Okay,
committee member and staff communications.
No, Madam Chair.
I have something.
Yes.
I would just like to announce that one of our previous committee members, Michael Jordan, is now officially a grandfather. He's his daughter Jacqueline gave birth on Monday to a boy called Hunter, 6 pounds for 14 ounces up in San Francisco. So congratulations, Mike.
Okay, thank you. On to business. First, we have a Southern Coastal Santa Barbara Creeks Bioassessment Program in 2014 report from, I don't see Jill.
And Madam Chair, Jeff Brinkman from Ecology Consultants has been performing this data collection and presentations for the last several years, and he's here tonight to give us the presentation.
Welcome, Jeff.
Jeff.
Okay, can you all hear me? I've had trouble with this thing in the past here. Okay, well, thanks for the introduction, Cameron. Sorry about the pink logo there for my company. That wasn't intentional, but I guess it's sticking out. So I'm here to talk about the South Coast Santa Barbara Streams and Estuaries Bioassessment Program. Let's see here. Okay, great. I don't think I want one too many there. Okay, so what is bioassessment? What are we talking about here when we say bioassessment? So basically we're using the biota. We're using the aquatic inhabitants of our streams and estuaries as the indicator of what is healthy or not healthy about our streams and estuaries. So it's the indicator of biological integrity, which is kind of another nebulous word. What does that mean? So basically that's the overall biological condition of an aquatic community. The species composition, the richness, which means how many different species live there. The trophic structure, which is like your balance of predators, prey, grazers, your primary producers. How is that structured in a particular water body, and how does that compare to what we would call natural habitat for the region. So in the absence of human disturbance, what should that look like? So that's what we mean by biological integrity. So why use rapid bioassessment? Why do we use bioassessment to indicate the condition of our water bodies? And it boils down to, why do we care about this? And habitat degradation pollution is really a biological problem. We don't really care about dissolved oxygen or conductivity or heavy metals in a water body for the sake of themselves. We care about them it's how they affect life that we are really concerned with. So these water chemistry measurements, which are useful, and we've spent a lot of time and money over the years studying and sampling water chemistry because of the way they affect life, but those are snapshots, and those vary highly, you know, with space and time, with storms where we get a lot of runoff and the pollution concentrations rise, and then, you know, that can change as our flows drop. The biota, on the other hand, instead of being like a little snapshot of what's happening right now, you know, they live for weeks, months, years in these water bodies. So depending on what you have living there, that is an indicator of what the condition of that water body has been over a much longer period of time. And also, bioassessment is proven. It's been in effect for well over 100 years. It's been shown to be effective around the world, and it's cost effective in comparison to a lot of other assessment methods. So as far as this program goes, what are the purposes of this program? And it's city plus county, so it's a jointly funded effort from the city and county. Both the city and county project Clean Water have been involved with this project for over 15 years in funding it. And what the intention of this, you know, from the outset, was to be a long-term monitoring program, to have a way to evaluate the biological integrity of our streams and then later our estuaries, which were added in, over a long period of time, and how they're responding. So, you know, how do our streams and estuaries respond to human development impacts and whether those are changing in a particular watershed over time, and then also to natural perturbations, things like variable rainfall and stream flow. We've shown to have large impacts on the stream biota. If we have flood years, that can have a very different effect than like right now when we're in a major drought. Wildfires, these type of natural events also have major impacts on our aquatic communities. It also allows us to detect impacts in sources of stream and estuary degradation. So if we are sampling at a particular point in a stream and everything looks great, we have good biological integrity, and maybe we're sampling a little bit further downstream, and all of a sudden our species diversity drops way off, we have a lot more pollution-tolerant species living there, we might say, okay, well, what's going on here? And that would give us a point of reference to start looking, okay, where is this impact coming in? Is there an illicit discharge? Is there too much sediment coming from an agricultural area? It allows us to kind of investigate and determine where some of these impacts might be coming from. It also, on the flip side of that, allows us to evaluate the either beneficial or negative impacts of restoration projects that we're trying to, or that we have been implementing here in the city. So it gives us a yardstick. You know, we know what the condition of the stream was before we restored it, and is that changing through time? Are we seeing a benefit? It gives us a way to determine that as well. Our study area, so South Coast Santa Barbara, we're talking about the south-facing drainages of the San Ynez Mountains from the county line there at Rincon all the way past Point Conception. Our westernmost watershed we look at is Halama. So it's a pretty large area. It's about 60 kilometers along the coast there. So let's talk about our streams. This is what we started off with. We've been studying the streams since 2000. It's been 15 years now. I can't believe it's gone by really quick for me. It's been 15 years. Amazing. So we look at about 15 to 20 reaches a year. We've looked at 50 different unique stream reaches. So we've sampled most of them, you know, well more than once. Some of them we sampled 15 years in a row. We've done a total of 273 stream surveys as of last year. So a lot of surveys. The city study reaches, the city has 9 study reaches, 9 to 10. It varies a little bit depending on the year, depending on where we want to sample. Some of them we sample every year, others we kind of move around depending on, you know, whether the city is doing a restoration project or is considering doing one at a different spot, we might start studying a different site. But they're in Mission, Sycamore, and Arroyo Borough, creek watersheds for the most part. And we look at a full range of creeks. So the top slide there is Mission Creek at Rocky Neck. It's a relatively undisturbed stream, not a lot of development impacts. You can see a beautiful creek channel, lots of boulders, cobble, lush riparian vegetation. And then the bottom is Mission Creek further downstream, right down there at De La Guerra. So we have an urban creek down there. We still have a natural bed, but we've got, you know, buildings and flood walls for banks, and we've got a lot of vegetation has been cleared, and we've got a lot of pollution inputs down there. And all the way from the mountains to the ocean. So we're looking at a full range of our creeks. Estuaries, we started studying about 4 years ago. So we did 10 sites last year. We've done 35 total. So we're newer, you know, we're newer in the process with looking at our estuaries. Kind of similar to creeks, we're trying to look at a full range. Obviously, estuaries are all, they're all right there on the coast, so there's no elevational differences, but we still have condition differences. So our urbanized estuaries, Mission, Sycamore, Arroyo Borough, are more highly disturbed. They have a lot more development and impacts in their watersheds that drain down to them. And then we've got some more moderately disturbed, like Tecolote, which is west of Goleta. It's got some agricultural impacts, a little bit of residential. And then our least disturbed estuaries that we're studying at this point are Halama and Gaviota. So let's talk a little bit about what we actually do. What is the actual work that we do for this program? And it all starts with our rapid bioassessment field survey. Whether it's a creek or an estuary, we're going out, we're doing benthic macroinvertebrate sampling. The benthic invertebrates are the kind of the crux of our program. They're the, the pillar of our program. So those are your aquatic insects, crustaceans, mollusks, snails, worms. Any invertebrate that's over a half millimeter in size is classified as a benthic macroinvertebrate. So we collect benthic invertebrate samples from the stream substrate and the estuarine substrate, the bottom sediments. We also do some basic water chemistry monitoring. We get our field meters out there. We measure dissolved oxygen, conductivity, temperature, pH, salinity. We do a physical habitat assessment. So we actually look at the stream or estuary, the physical habitat, the structure of it, you know, with a stream. What is the riparian corridor? Is it intact? How wide is it? What are the stream banks and bed? Are they composed of natural materials, or are they, you know, riprapped or concreted, or is there too much sediment in the stream? The riffles and pools, the actual habitat within the stream, does that look natural, or has that been altered? Is there a bulldozer driving down the creek every 3 or 4 years for flood control purposes? So we're scoring, we're assessing and scoring the habitat based on that, and I'll explain a little bit why we do that a little bit later. And then we also, it's not really the crux of what we do, but we do opportunistic plant and vertebrate species identification, and we have compiled lists of plant and animal species that are occurring at our different study sites over the years. We also look at aerial photos and quad maps and those type of things, and we've used those to determine things like the elevation of the site, the gradient of the stream, watershed land uses. We delineate the watersheds of all of our sites, and we map, you know, how much of that watershed is undisturbed wilderness, how much of it is agricultural development, you know, what percentage of it is urban development, and that helps us understand what condition that watershed is in. We do the laboratory work of the invertebrates, so we take the invertebrates back to the lab, we look at it, you know, we sort through them, we pick out the bugs, we look at them under a microscope, and we identify them, usually to the family level, and then we get a count of the, you know, the composition, and we look at 300 bugs per site for the streams and 150 per site for the estuaries. So there's a set number that we'll look at, and I'll explain how we use that information a little bit later as well. We also calculate index of biological integrity, or IBI scores, for the streams. I'll explain what that is in the next slide. It's basically a scoring system for the streams based on the benthic invertebrates. And then we do data analysis, statistical analysis, to look at relationships between, for example, human disturbance and some of our benthic invertebrate metrics, or water temperature or elevation, you know, some of the more natural factors in our invertebrate community. And then we also write an annual report to present all our results every year. So bear with me here. I know it's a lot of information. If you have any questions throughout, just let me know, or you can save them to the end. So the Index of Biological Integrity, as I said, it's basically a scoring system for our streams. And it is based on all of the data that we've collected at our streams. So it's not based on something else. It's based on what we've actually compiled here in this study area. So it's a composite score. We have 7 different core metrics. They're all represent a different aspect of the invertebrate community. So, for example, number of insect families, that would be like your richness or diversity metric. Number of EPT families, that's the number of caddisflies, mayflies, and stoneflies, which are known to be sensitive to pollution and indicative of excellent stream health. Percent sensitive BMIs, these are bugs that we, in addition to those that I was just describing, that we know are sensitive to pollution. Percent predators plus shredders, that's more of a functional feeding group metric. So these metrics, they represent different aspects of the invertebrate community, diversity, functional feeding, pollution sensitivity, and they're also highly related to human development. So the way that we select these metrics and incorporate them into our IBI is we take all of our sites, and all of our sites, let's say, on a scale of 0 to 100% disturbed in their watershed. You know, you got some sites that have no development, like Arroyo Hondo. You got some sites like Mission Creek and the lower reaches that have 50 to 60% of their watershed is urbanized or agriculture. So you do an X versus Y, and you plot number of insect families on the Y and percent watershed disturbed on the X, and you look for that relationship. And the metrics that show a very strong response or relationship with human disturbance are the ones that are on our IBI. They're our best indicators of stream health. Let's see here. So and what we're also trying to do is we're trying to simplify this information. We're talking about a lot of complex information, and we're trying to condense it down to something that people can understand. Someone that's not a stream taxonomist, you know, hey, is the stream very poor, fair, good, excellent? The IBI provides that scoring structure, which is, again, all based on the data we've collected. There's a very clear rationale and methodology to determining what those categories are. So it gives you a measure of the stream that everyone can understand, and it helps us guide our watershed management actions. I've mentioned restoration sites. We can use this and say, hey, this site down here is in very poor condition. We need to do something about this. How are we going to improve the habitat quality, or how are we going to improve the water chemistry? It allows us to identify those type of sites. It also helps us to monitor them through time and see if what we're doing is making a difference. The IBI is something this is the third time we've updated it. We just updated it this past year. It's the third version. It just gets refined a little bit at this point. Over the years, we have more range of conditions that we're sampling, different rainfall patterns. You know, we've got 3 years of drought right now, so our IBI scores are actually lower in most of the creeks in the last couple of years because there's not as much water. So it's allowing us to look at a lot of different range of climatic conditions, and it just gets a little bit better every time we redo it. Okay, anyone ready for a break? No? I'll try and power through this. We're about halfway, if that's all right. So what have we found? We found the IBI is very effective. And the graph you're looking at on the right there shows IBI scores, and the center of those diamonds, those green diamonds, is the mean IBI score for 3 different categories of stream reaches. You have highly disturbed stream reaches, which have a lot of development impacts, and we're looking at that a priori. That means when we make up those categories and we say you're either highly, moderately, or relatively undisturbed, which would be the reference, hey, how much development is there in the watershed, and what were the physical habitat scores at that site? And we combine those two things together, and then we classify all the sites before we look at any biological data. And we say, this is a reference site, this is moderately disturbed, this is highly disturbed. And then we take those classifications, and we say, what are the IBI scores? This is the end result after we've built this IBI. And what we show is what we see physically matches up very well with what we see biologically. There's a very distinct separation between these different groups. So the IBI works very well. In fact, it classifies our sites about 86 to 98% of the time accurately. So to two classes, that would mean if you had a reference site, either it was classified as good or excellent. To three classes, that would mean, okay, we have a reference site, so that's an undisturbed site. It would be classified as either fair, good, or excellent. So it wasn't classified as poor or very poor. So 98% of the time, this tool is doing that, which is pretty impressive. Some other things we found. Okay, so we have human impacts, which are kind of steady state. Unless you eliminate development or you do restoration that offsets some of that development, those impacts are there. They're not going away. We do have a lot of things that occur naturally, like flow, like rainfall and stream flow variations and wildfires that are kind of like episodic disturbances. Like they happen and then they impact the stream and then that stream recovers over time. So our streams are resilient. They bend and then they come back is what we have found. So this graph on the right, which is a little confusing, I have to admit, but if you look at it, you see a bunch of diamonds with IBI scores. That's an average IBI score by year in our streams. You see most of them are kind of similar. They're all kind of on that top end. There's 2 years that drop way out where the average IBI score at our streams was much lower. In fact, very significantly from a statistical perspective. And that was 2005, which was our second wettest year on record. Major scouring flows came through, blew out all the creeks, scoured everything out of them. So then when we went to sample them the next spring, there wasn't a lot left, right? And then the next year, boom, scores bounced back up in 2006. Basically took a year or two for the scores to recover. 2014, last year, third year in a row of extreme drought. So drought, first couple years, yeah, the streams are hanging in there. Boom, last year it kind of hit a critical level where there's not a lot of flow. You know, some of the streams are just standing pools. So now you're starting to see a real drop in the invertebrate community. And, you know, if we get some good flows this winter, probably this year it's going to be even worse. Now maybe we'll get some good flows next winter. Hopefully the streams will recover. But this program is allowing us to track those natural changes too. And, you know, if global warming's true and we're going to get more or less rainfall, depending on, I mean, no one really knows, but this could be something if a drought is something that becomes more common here, we could see more of this. And this will allow us to monitor that. Wildfires, another episodic disturbance. So if you look at the graph on the right there, there's a couple of sites, the red and blue on the top there that were up at 50 and 60. Those are Mission Creek at Rocky Nook and Rattlesnake Creek, which are the two reference undisturbed sites in that group that are up there. Each line represents a different stream. We saw IBI scores before, this was before the Jesusita fire. So we sampled about a week before that fire. The scores were great for those two sites. They were up in the good, excellent range. Fire came through, we sampled the next year. We're talking about 70 to 80% of the watershed burned. We had some pretty big flows the next winter. We came back the next year. Those sites both scored in the poor range. Major impacts to those sites. But then you see over the next 2 years, the scores gradually got back up to normal. That doesn't mean that the community is totally the same. There's some species that don't come back that quick. Like, for example, Rattlesnake Creek and Mission at Rocky Nook, we always saw trout there. Every year we saw trout until the fire. We haven't seen trout there since. I hear there's some trout somewhere in Mission Creek, but they're not at those two sites. So it might take, you know, who knows? It's been 5 years. It might take 10 years for those species to return to those sites. I talked a little bit about restoration projects. So we have a couple in the city that have been going on for quite a few years. M2, that's Rocky Nook Park. I'm sorry, that's Bonnet Park, so the old Mission Creek Channel. That project began in 2004, so over 10 years ago. And then AB5 is the Mesa Creek site, which was the daylighted creek. Was a storm drain, got daylighted, empties into Arroyo Burro Estuary. So we've used this IBI to monitor those sites before, and well, before for Bonnet, you couldn't really monitor Mesa before because it was a underground pipe, but we've monitored these sites since the restoration to try and see, is there any change in IBI scores? And kind of what we found, and we look at other things, there's been major improvements in the riparian habitat and riparian canopy cover at these sites. If you go out and look at what the city's done, the plant communities there are awesome. They're amazing. What we're not really seeing is we're not really seeing much, if any, of a change in the invertebrate community actually in the stream. And, you know, if you think about it, it kind of makes sense. I mean, replanting a couple hundred meters of stream channel has benefits, but you can't expect that stream to now be back to what it was. There's still a tremendous amount of impacts in the watershed, water quality issues, sedimentation, habitat fragmentation. I mean, there's no upland habitat around those sites anymore. So certain creatures aren't going to be able to get back to the sites, and some aren't going to be able to survive there anyway because they might rely on having adjacent upland habitat. Like a California newt, for example, has to be able to crawl out of the stream. They breed in the stream, and then they crawl out, and they've got to be able to burrow and hide out as it dries out in the summer. A lot of aquatic insects have to feed on upland vegetation. So if there's none around that site, they're not going to be able to survive there. So we have to realize that a lot of our impacts that we've created are permanent and they're not going away. There's a certain bar we can probably get to, and you know, it's not like we're going to bulldoze our developed areas. That's not going to happen. Moving on to estuaries. So we're newer in the process with estuaries. We're kind of still in the beginning stages. We're getting a little bit out of the beginning stage, actually. We're starting to figure some things out. So we calculate benthic invertebrate metrics just like for streams, things like abundance, diversity, you know, the number of species present, functional feeding groups, sensitivity, tolerance, metrics that are based on those things. Similar to streams, we have the reference moderately disturbed and highly disturbed estuaries. And what we're doing is we're looking for metrics that show differences between these sites. What is a good metric that's going to allow us to differentiate between these sites? That's going to be a good indicator of biological health, basically, or biological integrity. A little tougher with estuaries because they're really harsh environments. You've got massive fluctuations in salinity, temperature, water volume, size. There's less organisms that are able to adapt and survive in an estuary because of all these mass scale changes that occur throughout the year and from year to year. So that makes it a little bit tougher, actually, to find metrics that are going to differentiate between these different conditions. We have found that fall sampling is better. We tried the spring at first. We didn't see any difference between reference sites and highly disturbed sites. We sampled in the fall. That allows the water regime to kind of establish, the salinity stabilizes, and then the community matures, and now we're starting to see differences in the fall sampling. So what we found so far, on the right we have another one of these little plots showing the highly disturbed, moderately disturbed, and reference groups, and what you see on the y-axis there is percent sensitive BMIs. So we're seeing an excellent spread for this metric between these three categories. Percent tolerant, similar, and then the other three, sensitive taxa, collector gatherers, predators, those aren't quite as good, but they're still statistically different, significantly different between the sites. And then salinity effects, like I mentioned, we got a huge fluctuation in salinity between our estuaries. Some of them are like one part per thousand salinity, others are over 30. It's a huge fluctuation. We have we have two twin estuaries that are right next to each other. One, the salinity was like 3 parts per thousand. The other, it was 40. I have no idea why, but it was. What we found is between 0 and 30 parts per thousand, our metrics are holding up pretty well. Over 30, we've only sampled a few sites. Then we're starting to see maybe the salinity is really what's driving the invertebrate community. And it's overwhelming the disturbance impacts. We're not seeing differences between, or rather, we don't have any reference sites in that category, but we're seeing bugs at highly disturbed sites that we would normally only see at reference sites. So we're not sure what's going on at the really high salinities. We need more data, and we need to look at some reference sites if that happens, that happen to have a salinity that's that high. We do see some definite patterns with individual taxa. We have taxa that only occur at low salinity, others that are only at high salinity, and some that are ubiquitous. They're at all salinities. So trying to wrap up here, thanks for your patience. This year for streams, we're looking at drought effects. That's kind of the main thing this year. How much more of an effect is this drought going to have on the streams? And then estuaries, we're trying to fill in more of these data gaps, more reference sites, more high salinity sites. We're going to continue to look at our indicator metrics, try and refine them, and hopefully in 2 to 3 years we'll have an estuarine IBI, which would be similar to the streams. That's kind of our goal in that respect. So thanks for your patience. Any questions, comments?
Thanks, Jeff, for that presentation.
You're welcome.
Very informative.
Sure.
Questions?
It's my pleasure.
Comments?
Is there a place I can get some of the raw data that you have, like a list, your species lists?
Absolutely. It is in the appendices of the report. So the report for last year was just finalized. So Jill has it.
Okay.
And I'm assuming it'll be on the city's website pretty soon here. Looks okay. Like Cameron's got a copy of the introduction to the report. So the appendices have all, this year they have all of the raw data for all, excuse me, all years of study. It's all there.
Cool, thanks.
Yeah, you got it. Anything else? No? Okay.
No?
Have a great night.
Thank you. You have any questions before Jeff sneaks out, Lee? Okay. On to our next item, the fiscal year 2016-2017 budget.
Okay, thank you, Madam Chair and committee members. Tonight we'll be presenting the proposed budget for fiscal years 2016 and 2017. We'll probably spend most of our time focusing on the 2016, but we'll cover both. I want to start out by talking a little bit about how the budget process works. Most of you have gone through this and are familiar with it, but not everyone. So just a few things about how it works. This is the city works on a two-year budget planning cycle, and this is the first year of that. So we look at 2 years, but we will be back to the committee next year with our FY17 budget for you to have another look at that and make any adjustments that we need to make. We start out our process with the budget subcommittee. We met back in February and kind of talked about generally what we were looking at, and then we met on April 17th to kind of go over, we went over everything really pretty much line by line and discussed, you know, the minute issues as well as larger issues. We're at the committee today, and I was also earlier this afternoon at the Parks and Recreation Commission giving the presentation. One thing I want to say about that is this committee makes a recommendation to the Parks and Recreation Commission and to the City Council. The commission supported the proposed budget, but subject to this committee's recommendation, and any issues raised by the committee will go to their chair and be part of their presentation to the City Council as well. And then the city's budget was presented to City Council yesterday, which is why we had to move our meeting to today to discuss this. And the Creeks Division budget will be presented to the City Council on May 11th as part of the Parks and Recreation Commission budget. City Council will make its final decisions on the budget in about the third week of June, and all of these meetings are publicly noticed meetings that anyone can attend. As you guys all know, most of the funding for the Creeks Division comes from the voter-approved Measure B, which was passed in November 2000. It's a 2% transient occupancy tax or hotel bed tax. The funds from that tax go into a special fund that is restricted for that's use is restricted for stormwater and surface water quality improvement, as well as creek restoration efforts. The Creeks Division doesn't get any funding from the general fund. It's just Measure B and grants, some other sources. So getting to the numbers, these are projections for the next two fiscal years. The city's finance department makes projections of TOT revenues coming in Measure B. And as you can see, they're projecting increases in transient occupancy tax over the next 2 years compared to this year. We also have some revenues coming from interest income. That's fairly stable. And then other revenues, that 13,000 you see is contributions from the City of Goleta and Santa Barbara County for some of our outreach efforts. And so our total revenues are projected to increase over the next 2 years. Getting to our expenditure side of things, we are proposing a budget that is substantially similar to what we have had or what we have in the current year, fiscal year 2015, with a few exceptions. First, our proposed capital program expenditures are reduced. If I can get down, that's the second to last line down here. So we're dropping from $1,475,000 in FY15 to $1,325,000 in FY16. And then other differences include some relatively minor changes in our supplies and services area. You see a little bump up there. Part of that is with our creek cleanup program. We're increasing our efforts dealing with some homeless. We've had higher levels of homeless encampments along the creek, so we're increasing our efforts at cleanup in that area. We're also going to be piloting adding another day to our shoreline beach cleanups along the waterline. We started that program as a pilot program in one area a couple of years ago, and so we go out once a week and do that. We're going to see what happens if we go twice a week and see if we continue to get the same levels of trash at that, and we'll look at a cost benefit analysis on that and decide whether to go forward. We also have some increased water quality research we're doing with neonicotinoid pesticides, and then we've added a new line item for some of the weed management on the property the Creeks Division purchased up in the upper Arroyo Borough watershed. This is a chart showing the breakdown by different categories of how the funds are spent. As usual, our largest single line item in our budget this year is our capital program at 35%, followed by salaries and benefits for Creeks Division staff and supplies and professional services. And this is the breakdown by program area. The Creeks Division has three program areas. One is water quality improvement, one is creek restoration, and one is community outreach and education. And I've broken out the these numbers to show the percentages with capital projects, but also if we remove the capital projects from it, you see it affects the distribution of the funds by the percentage. Obviously we don't have a lot of community outreach capital, so that number drops when you put capital in, but when you take it out, we're roughly in the area that the committee has directed us in the past, which is 50% water quality, 25% creek restoration, 25% community outreach. And this is our chart showing the breakdown by the program area, and it kind of breaks out the capital and the operating budgets for each of those issue areas. Some of the highlights from this year's budget: our Measure B revenues are projected to go up $430,000 from the FY15 budget. We've got a $150,000 decrease in our transfer for our capital improvement program proposed for next year, and I mentioned these others: an increase in our creek cleanup and water quality research funding. Also, something different from the last several years is, in the last several years, we have been taking money out of our reserves to fund part of our capital program next year, because we've decreased our capital transfer and we have increased revenues. We're proposing to transfer some funds, $280,000, into the reserve at the end of the year. These are some of the line items involving specific areas of our programs. Our water quality research and monitoring program numbers are staying substantially the same compared to past years, with the exception of of this, which is increased to, by 25,000 to cover the pesticide research I mentioned. We have ongoing programs. I mentioned the creek cleanups, but we also have youth watershed education. Our TV and radio campaigns is increasing just slightly to adjust for cost increases we're seeing there. And the other areas are staying the same as last year. This is an outline of our capital program funding for the next 2 years. All of these projects have been funded in past budget cycles. I just wanted to mention a couple of these. The one at the top, Las Positas Creek Restoration Project. That's a restoration on a tributary to Arroyo Burro that runs along Las Positas Road. We're looking at replacing a concrete channel there and restoring that creek to a natural condition. It's definitely associated with a large capital project we did on the municipal golf course, which is the upper portion of that watershed, and then we'll have covered most of the most of that entire tributary watershed. We finished some technical studies for that. We've finished conceptual design. We're moving into final design on that project. The second one on the list is stormwater treatment retrofit projects. You guys are aware of the demonstration projects we've done in Stevens Park and McKenzie Park, Oak Park, and Westside Neighborhood Center. In about 2 weeks, we're moving forward with kind of the next stage of our demonstration projects. We're doing a service road that's sort of like an alleyway through Plaza de Veracruz Park. And then we're going to be replacing the sidewalks that surround Ellis Keck Park Memorial Gardens with permeable pavers as a demonstration for how the city could do other hardscape around the city. The following year in that project, we'll be actually replacing a street, a roadway and sidewalks down along Quarantina Street. And then lastly, I just wanted to bring up the Arroyo Burro, Upper Arroyo Burro restoration project. That's where the Creeks Division purchased 14 acres up in the, just above Foothill on the Arroyo Burro watershed. We've completed a conceptual design for that restoration project and are moving into final design. The Creeks Division unappropriated reserves are largely due to grants and increasing TOT as well as program efficiencies we've had over the last couple of years. We're projecting our year-end balance for FY15 to be about $5 million, and we're proposing, as I mentioned, to transfer our surplus into the reserves at the end of FY16. Now, I want to remind everyone that that number and balance could change significantly due to a proposed acquisition project. The Trust for Public Land came about 2 weeks ago to City Council and gave a presentation about the potential purchase of a 15-acre property in the Lower Arroyo Burro watershed. They've been actively working to secure grants for that project. So far, they have about $800,000 in grants. It's a $4 million acquisition. They have another grant application in for $500,000, which would take them to $1.3 million, and I know they're actively searching for more. They haven't asked the city for funds for that acquisition, but they may do that in the future, and Measure B would be a possible source of funding to make up the difference to cover the cost of that acquisition. I think the Trust for Public Land's hope is to turn that property over to the city for creek restoration and open space park. So that obviously could have a pretty dramatic impact on the reserve balance. The reserve target set by this committee is about $3 million, and the purpose of that reserve has been established as capital projects, leveraging grant funding, and to make up for revenue shortfalls in challenging economic times. Our grant picture for the next couple of years, or at least for the next year, is looking good. We already have been awarded a grant for this fiscal year for $2.3 million from the State Water Resources Control Board, and that is funding a significant portion of our permeable paver demonstration projects. We have $1.25 million in grant applications pending. One is with the State Department of Water Resources for the Las Positas Creek restoration. It's $1 million application. It's received a staff recommendation. It's put out on a published list by the Department of Water Resources. They have their in mid-May they'll have their board meeting where they'll make a decision on that application. So we're very hopeful that that will come through. And then we also have a $250,000 grant in front of C grant for the pesticide research project. This slide shows how we've leveraged Measure B funding in our capital program over the last several years, and it shows a couple of interesting things. One is, you know, as you can see, we've, as far as our capital program goes, it's more than half of the funding is coming from grants. In some grant years, now the blue shows the funding coming from Measure B, the green is the grant funding. And again, this is only the Measure B funding going to the capital program, not showing all Measure B funding. But we do have several years in the past, say 5 or 6 years, where our grant funding has surpassed all of the total Measure B funds coming into the program. And you can see those here in FY10, 13, and I think in 12 as well. FY15, everything from FY15 backwards is all our actual grant numbers, and FY16 is just shown as a projection. Over the life of the Creeks program, we've received over $17 million in grant funding. And one thing that this graph doesn't show is other opportunities we've had to partner with other agencies to secure grants for projects that will benefit the city. And so we'll continue to look for grant opportunities going forward, and those are federal, state, and private foundation grants. Proposition 1 was a water bond passed by voters last November. There are a lot of new programs coming online with funding from that bond measure. Most if not all of the programs are not going to be useful for us in terms of the acquisition that I mentioned earlier in Lower Arroyo Borough, but they are focused on restoration. And there's approximately $500 million statewide that is going into water quality and creek restoration type projects. So I'm very hopeful that we will be competitive for some of those funds. And with that, I will conclude and be happy to answer any questions anyone has. Oh, excuse me, I'm sorry. I do have one last thing. With regard to expenditures, the committee had a presentation on the city street sweeping program in January and had sent a memo with asked several questions that I told the committee I would come back during the budget presentation to talk about. Those questions have been passed along and elevated to the department head level at the city. The department heads have been meeting and discussing those things and expect to have responses to the committee's questions by our next meeting. I think they had hoped to have them by tonight, but I think by our May meeting we'll have responses on those, and I will bring those to the committee as soon as I have them. Okay.
Thanks for that update and for the presentation. Have questions? Discussion?
Thank you, Madam Chair. Great overview, Mr. Benson. I was wondering whether in the overall budget presentation to the City Council yesterday or to the Parks and Recreation Commission this afternoon, whether anyone offered any suggestion or recommendation on our portion of the proposed upcoming budget.
Madam Chair, Mr. Moldaver, the presentation to the City Council didn't get into a lot of detail about our about the Creeks Division budget. It was more of a broad presentation, and we'll get into more of the detail with the City Council when we do our presentation on May 11th. The Commission was a more focused presentation. They made a specific motion, which was passed unanimously, to support the budget subject to this committee's input.
Thank you. Okay. Do you have?
I don't have a question. I have a comment, though. I attended a free showing of a film that was recently completed called Eyes in the Sky, and it was shown in Carpinteria, and it was dealing with water issues, but more of climate change and drought conditions that covered the Colorado River and the Ogallala. I'm not sure how to pronounce that. That giant aquifer in the Midwest. And so they interviewed several people, and one of them was Supervisor Steve Bennett in Ventura County. And he mentioned some of our projects, like the McKinsey Park parking lot in this film, and how the City of Santa Barbara is replacing pavement with pavers to have infiltration. And I was kind of very happy to see that here's this film, and they're talking about a Santa Barbara project in Ventura County. So I just wanted to make that comment.
Thank you. Any other questions, comments? Okay. Yes.
I just had one comment, not only from our City College students here in the audience, but people who are watching this later. And I want to thank Mr. Benson for pointing out the tradition of this program for their ingenuity and success in leveraging local tax money to bring in several times that amount from other agencies and areas of government, public bonds, and various foundations, so that very often people are wondering what happens to our sales tax dollar, and are they being well protected and well spent. And I think if you look year after year, and I think the bar graph near the end indicated that, the bar chart, since the beginning of the committee under Mayor Harriet Miller and Jill Zachary, the level of success, which reflects a lot of research and hard work, getting really tight grant applications, almost every year brings in a lot more money for projects to the community than are actually being spent from the local tax dollars that are funding it. And I know people on the street and people in the visitor serving industry often wonder how well we're doing. And I thought it was good that you emphasized that bar chart at the end, because the tradition, even with the recovery from the weak economy several years ago, is still going forward to be really careful and ingenious in how you leverage and spend local money.
Yes, please, Ms. Loma.
I'd like to add something to that, and I'm glad you brought it up. some of the money comes from state and federal, so all that money is coming into Santa Barbara, and some of these projects are being built by local companies and local consultants. So that money comes to us and then gets distributed to the residents in the Santa Barbara area. So it's not just kept in a small area like the city coffers. It gets back distributed back to people that live here and work in construction, work in earth moving and consulting. So that is something that I would hope people would understand as well. Obtaining grant money from the feds just helps us, our bottom line here in Santa Barbara.
I echo those accolades. Yeah. Anything further? Okay, this was an action item.
Yeah, Madam Chair, I would move that we recommend adoption of the 2016-17 draft budget as presented today, and recommend it to the City Council for approval and adoption in their budget hearings later this year.
Thank you. Do we have a second?
I'll second that.
Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Any opposed or abstained? Okay, none.
Thank you.
Thank you. If there's nothing else, then we have a motion to adjourn.
I'll make that motion.
I'll second that.
Thank you. Okay, we're adjourned.
Thanks.
Not an empty plate. That's if you appreciate yourself. Every time you're near a rose, aren't you glad you've got a nose? And if the dawn is fresh with dew, aren't you glad you're you? When a meadowlark appears, aren't you glad you've got two ears? And if your heart is singing too, aren't you glad you're you? You can see a summer sky, or touch a friendly hand, or taste an apple pie. Pardon the grammar, but ain't life grand? And when you wake up each